If you are the loudest voice in the town square or the subtle hand behind the scenes, we are glad you are here. If you have failed once or a thousand times, we are glad you are here. If you sing like angels or mumble behind the hymnal, we are glad you are here. This community is what it is because of your presence. So welcome, welcome into this space of love, support, justice, compassion, fellowship, and worship. We are glad you are here. I have one quick reminder before we greet each other, and that is that there will be no post-service discussion after the service today. I'd now like to recognize our lovely live stream attendees. If you're joining us online, and especially if this is your first time, please send a note to checking in at winchesteruu.org with your name, where you're watching from, and anything else that's on your mind. Those here in the sanctuary, let's now turn to welcome our amazing live stream attendees by waving to the camera above the welcoming congregation banner. And now let's turn to greet one another in person.
To worship is to stand in awe under a heaven of stars before a flower, a leaf in the sunlight, or a grain of sand. To worship is to be silent, receptive before a tree astir with the wind or the passing shadow of a cloud. To worship is to work with dedication and with skill. It is to pause from work and listen to a strain of music. To worship is to sing with the singing beauty of the earth. It is to listen through a storm to the still small voice within. Worship is a loneliness seeking communion. It is a thirsty land crying out for rain. Worship is kindred fire within our hearts. It moves through deeds of kindness and through acts of love. Worship is the mystery within us reaching out to the mystery beyond. It is an inarticulate silence yearning to speak. It is the window of the moment open to the sky of the eternal. I now invite Ella to light our chalice.
As I now light the chalice, please join in singing "Rise Up, O Flame." The words are in your order of service.
Thank you.
please rise in body or in spirit to join in singing hymn number 394 in the gray hymnal, Come Let's Be Singing, Hava Nashira. We will sing the English words only. At this time, you are invited to come forward and light a candle and share a joy or a sorrow that you carry within. Please note that because this service is being live streamed, it's available over the internet in the moment and as an archived recording. If anyone wishes to have a candle brought to them, please raise your hand.
Hi, I would like to, I'm George, just so, hello everybody. I would like to light a candle for my husband today, so thanks. Oops.
Hi, I'm Sheila, and I would like to light a candle for joy because we've been working on a garden plan for our house using a lot of native flowers and shrubs and stuff, and we finally got it all planted, and it seems to be growing, and we had a party yesterday to invite the local garden group to come and check it out, and it was so much fun, and it was just, it was great.
We now light one final candle for all the unspoken joys and sorrows that remain in our hearts. We will be together for a time of silence, and then we will come together for our second hymn, number 1002, from the teal hymnal, Comfort Me.
As you know, today is our second annual hymn summer service. And after the summer choir performs, I will be asked, helping John, ask you all to give us your favorite hymns so that we can all sing them together. But thinking about today and about the many hymns that we sing and that I love led me back to the oldest collection of hymns we have in the Judeo-Christian tradition, which is the Book of Psalms, which, as you all know, is in the Hebrew Bible. Composed long ago by poets and songwriters with very different understandings in many respects of the world than we have, the Psalms, even in translation, are striking nonetheless in the enduring power of their imagery, their ability to comfort, and the 23rd Psalm is a perfect example of that, and in the sheer beauty of some of the poetry. Most importantly for today, they embody how ancient and how enduring the importance of hymns and singing have always been in worship. In Jewish, Christian, and even in Islamic tradition, the authorship of the Psalms is attributed to King David, and this is not surprising. David was the shepherd boy who was elevated to kingship over Israel and who was, we are told, a musician and singer of songs without peer. It appears that he was so well known for his musical ability that when King Saul, David's predecessor, was suffering from anxiety and depression, as the Bible puts it in 1 Samuel, an evil spirit from the Lord troubled him, he sent for David. And again, in the words of the Bible, quote, David took his harp and played with his hand, and Saul was refreshed and was well, and the evil departed from him. The Hebrew Bible clearly describes David as writing psalms. And I should note that the Hebrew word for psalm is mizmor, which simply means something sung. And in the 2 Samuel, at the end of his life, David is described as, quote, the sweetest psalmist in Israel, the sweetest songwriter in Israel. However, it's clear, just from the internal evidence of the Psalms themselves, that David couldn't have written most of them because they tell of events that happened long after he lived. We might have some of David's actual compositions. Scholars say the Psalms were written from, believe it or not, 1000 BCE, before the Common Era, to 500 BCE, and David, we think, was living in 1000 BCE. But while we can't be certain that any of the Psalms we have were the work of David, I have to tell you that for me, some of them express a sweetness, a poignancy, even an insecurity and a longing that is entirely consistent with the David that I see depicted in the Hebrew Testament. Be that as it may, what's important for us today is that the Psalms were sung and are still sung in Jewish and Christian, and I dare say in Unitarian Universalist services. As poetry and music, like the hymns that we sing, they continue to comfort many. Now, to be sure, the Book of Psalms is named in Hebrew Tehillim, which means praise. And indeed, they are all pretty uniformly works that praise God, which may not attract many of us today. But I urge you, if you do turn to the Psalms, not to let that get in the way of their poetry, of their beauty, and of their ability to comfort. One quick example for me is the 30th Psalm. There, the songwriter is writing of God's anger. And in the King James translation, he says, or she says, we don't know who the songwriter was, quote, for his anger endureth but a moment, in his favor is life. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy cometh in the morning. Now, when I read that, I forget about God's anger, and I focus instead on the fact that joy will come in the morning, and that always comforts me. So let us sing our own form of praise today, as the ancient singers did theirs in Israel, and as generations have done while worshiping remembering in a phrase that is often attributed to another ancient, Saint Augustine, that to sing is to pray twice.
And if I can just introduce our anthem here, touching on what Martin was just saying, we actually have a song setting of Psalm 23. It's been a long liturgical tradition in the Jewish and Christian worships to sing psalms during worship. Here is a setting of Psalm 23 in a metric setting to a tune called Land of Rest. And I just want to just do a little educational outreach. If you look in your hymnal at any hymn, on the bottom part, there's some names, there's some authors and composers, and then there's a name of the tune. And every hymn has a name of, has a tune name. This tune name is called Land of Rest, and I think you'll recognize it. We sing it commonly with some different words, but here it is with the words for the 23rd Psalm.
Save my voice. Although I can shout all the time. So who has a favorite hymn that they would like us to sing? Don't be shy, don't be shy.
298.
Okay, 298. So we have 298, and then we have hymn number one.
Thank you.
And next we have hymn number one. Who said 159? I didn't hear that, but we'll do 159 next. We'll do one and then 159. Okay? Now I have two online in queue, 159 and 16. Any others? Thank you. Thank you for all the hymns we've chosen so far. They are so great. We have such great hymns. Okay. The next one is 16.
What is it?
16, 1-6. Different, a little different change of pace.
Yep.
Great. And the next one is 191. Turn our pages. Our next hymn is 123.
Thank you.
We have time for one or two more. 120. Say it again?
108.
Okay.
Oh, that's our closing hymn.
Oh. Can't sing that one. So I heard 121. 121. And then any other? One more?
21.
Hold on. What are we saying? Just 21. Somebody said 121 and somebody said 21. So let's do those.
121 and then 21.
Correct. Correct. And then our final hymn for our hymn sing this summer is hymn number 21.
Thank you.
thank you all who named their hymns, and let's sing more next summer and throughout the year.
With the offering, each week we are invited to cultivate generosity by contributing to the financial health of this self-supporting church. Generosity, like love, like kindness, is stimulated by the frequency of its exercise. The more often we give generously, the more we have to give. Here are the different ways you can donate. Those in the sanctuary may give cash, checks, precious metals, or you can donate electronically. Send a text to the number in your order of service, or visit our website under the giving page, although electronic funds transfer seems to be disabled at the moment, but I'm hoping they'll fix that. If you're visiting for the first time, either in person or online, you are our guest. In-person attendees can find a physical visitor card in the pew racks in front of you. Please complete it and put it in the collection plate. Information about how to give online and how to complete the virtual visitor card will soon be shared with live stream attendees through the text on your screen. Your generously given offering will now be gratefully accepted.
I've got a roof over my head. I've got a warm place to sleep. Some nights I lie awake counting gifts instead of counting cheese. I've got a heart that can hold. Remember.
Those who wish to do so are invited to join in the unison affirmation. We gather not for ourselves alone, but to use our common power to build the beloved community within and beyond these walls. We create and reaffirm this covenant this day to make justice flourish, to practice compassion amidst difference, and to embody transformative love. Please now rise in body or in spirit to join in singing hymn number 108 from the Gray Hymnal, How Can I Keep From Singing?
Let us go out into the world singing. Let us go out into the world singing songs that proclaim liberty, songs that turn ashes into garlands, songs that bind up the afflicted and those who mourn, songs that, like oaks, have roots that go deep and stand strong. Let us go out into the world singing. We know these songs. They vibrate through time. In our very souls, they are the songs that give us life. They are the songs that give us purpose. Now it is our turn to take these life-giving songs out into the world. Let us go now, singing these songs with voices deep and strong, and may the world join us in praise and in celebration and in love. Amen.
Thank you.
please read together the words for extinguishing the chalice. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. The service has ended, but our life of service continues. Please join us for food and refreshments at social hour.